so you know, DJ drama. Yeah. Drama. So the role of the DJ. The DJ was, I like to say, the DJ is the medium. You know, the DJ is the medium between the music and the people. You know, they're the ones who bring the music to the people. Now that's a DJ in his rawest original form. A lot of the foundation is credited to Cool Herc, you know, for really discovering or, you know, creating the creation of hip hop. You know, and he's a DJ. You know, so as much as the MC is in the forefront, a lot of the roots of hip hop always lead back to the DJ. You know, Cool Herc was originally from Jamaica, came to the States, and you know, what we know about reggae music, you know that, you know, a lot of times the MC at the same time as the DJ, and you know, they have control of the music, and that was kind of what Cool Herc, you know, did for the game and brought that to the forefront of what hip hop is. There was a DJ named Doo-Wop, of course, it was Cool. And Doo-Wop basically had a tape, and what he did was that, you know, he had a lot of freestyles on his tape. It was called 95 Live. And when he put it out, you know, like a lot of things I talk about is crazy because at the time they were revolutionary, but now it's so basic. He had all the big artists in the game rapping on his tape. It was like the hottest thing I had heard at the time. And it was just amazing to watch him do that. A DJ in the late 80s, early 90s, named Ron G. Ron G was real big on the mixtape side of things. And, you know, what he was known for was basically took a cappella R&B songs and put them on hip hop beats. You know, sounds real basic, you know, nothing special. But at the time, it was something, you know, fresh and brand new. Right around the time when crunk music was real hot in the South. And I felt like artists in the South weren't really getting it just due with how thorough they were, you know, with being top notch, you know what I mean? I mean, you had Outkast, you had people early on, you know, you had your T.I.s or, you know, I can't think of everybody at the moment, but, you know, just in general, you know, artists in the South weren't getting it just due with, or even like a Scarface or somebody like that with lyricism of, you know, competing with the top contenders on them spots. So, you know, that was the direction I kind of wanted to take with what I was doing. And the way I became a DJ was, you know, actually by a fake DJ. You know, I went to go see the movie Juice and the character GQ. That was it for me. I remember I was just about to go into high school and I was like, man, that's something I want to try to do. So. That was the first time I had really like visually seen a DJ, you know, in action, like cutting and, you know, bringing back and doing tricks and all that, and I was fascinated by it. I basically stole my name, to be honest.
That's what's up.
I had a homie that was used to sell mixtapes in Philly named Bakari, and I had another man named Hakeem. Hakeem used to call Bakari Drama. Bakari wasn't a DJ, so he never did nothing with the name. So I kind of just told him, like, yo, let me use that. You're not using that. So I took the name Drama. I remember it just was so powerful at the time. You know, when this was like when I was like 15, 16. So then after that, through my career, I always tried to change my name because once I took the name, I felt as though it was going to be too hard for me to get on with that name because it was such a common word in so many ways and it was so regular that nobody was going to be able to think about me as a DJ when they heard the word Drama. So, you know, I tried to change it at times and it just never worked. Like, it never panned out. So I always kind of came back to the name DJ Drama. You know, I've had somewhat of some drama in my career, so I might have named myself Easy Going if I'd have known it. You know what I mean? Hip-hop, black music is, to me, the biggest export of America that we have. Like, if you think about it, you know, you can go anywhere in the world and you can hear 50 Cent, you can hear Stevie Wonder, you can hear Marvin Gaye or Lauryn Hill. You can't go to Sweden and hear something from China. Or you can't go to Australia and hear something from Bulgaria. But you go anywhere in the world and hear some form of black music and they know it. Just like oil from another country. Or just like, so, you know what I mean? Like, And because of that, you know, like they take it very seriously. So in other countries, you know, they study our music to a science, to a T, and know it inside and out. And you know, there's artists that, you know, would get laughed at right now if they came in here that can go overseas and still tour and still make money because they have a different type of respect for the music.
Well, that is it. And we appreciate
you
coming. Appreciate
y'all. Thank you.